Well, on behalf of George Kipros and his family, I want to thank you for gathering this morning to honor the life of Bess Kipros. You can read the story of her life in the program, how she was born in Greece. She was brought here to the United States at the age of one. She was raised in Mansfield, Ohio. I know where Mansfield, Ohio is. There's a high school in Mansfield that beat me in the finals of the state championship of basketball my senior year of high school, so I've not had good memories of Mansfield until I met Bess. That changed all of that. She came here to Detroit for her education, and not only got her education at Wayne State University, but she met George and raised her family here and pursued a teaching career at Madonna University. And by your presence here, we can all speak of the contribution that she has made into the lives of so many people. And we're grateful to be able to honor her today. She was predeceased by her parents, as well as her son, Christopher. She is survived by her husband, George, by her son, George Jr., his wife, Suzanne, my son, Paul, brother, Jack, sister-in-law, Linda, and Desi, and five nieces and nephews. Revelation chapter 21 says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea is no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.' Also, he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' And he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give from the springs of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son.'" Let's pray. Our gracious God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we gather here today to honor your servant, Bess Kipros. We are so thankful for the influence of her life. We are ultimately thankful for the life that she had because of Christ and the life that she enjoys now because of and with Christ. We ask that in our gathering this morning that our own hearts will be more tender as a result to what really matters in life, and that the message of the life that she lived and the message of the gospel will become so precious to us, and particularly to those who need clarity on that. Open their eyes to Christ today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You have the program. We will follow that. I'll not introduce every speaker. They will just come up in order. We'll begin by singing together, though, hymn number 1, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
You'll find the text there in the hymnal in front of you. Let's stand together as we sing.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away.
Third stanza.
Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Wellspring of the joy of living, ocean's depth of there be raised. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine.
You may be seated.
This is Brother Jack. Vasiliki, Bess Kipros. To me, she was Bess the best. Passed away Wednesday, April 19th this year. She was born with immigrant parents. She was born on July 4th, 4th of July, and I was George Washington's birthday, gosh. On Plumadi in the island of Lesbos, and our parents were Zanos and Areti Gogatas. In 1938, they came to Mansfield, Ohio, and graduated from Mansfield Senior High School, receiving a PTA scholarship to study education. She completed her major in elementary education from Wayne State University. That's what brought her here in 1950. Shortly after, she married George Peter Kipros and began raising a family of 3 sons. George Jr., who's sitting right next to George, Big George, Paul, and Christopher, 3 boys. During these years, she taught preschool and was active in school and church activities. And when George Jr. and Paul went off to college, Christopher went to Shepherd School and Home for the Mentally Impaired, the youngest son. Bess returned to Wayne State and completed a master's degree in preschool and parent and earned, at age 50, her PhD, a doctorate in higher and adult education, at age 50. In 1989, Bess joined the faculty at Madonna here, and she directed and taught in the Child Development Early Childhood Program for 22 years, Fasolaki Bess. She was active in local, state, and national levels, conducting research, presenting and publishing her work in early childhood, and represented many on boards representing children and families. And after retirement, she remained active in her church, which, in case you don't know it, is Cornerstone Baptist Church, teaching biblical topics, coordinating a volunteer tutor program for children from Detroit, and facilitating Hope for You, a support group for those facing challenging illnesses. Her desire to become a certified biblical counselor, she was really interested in that, but it was thwarted by her reoccurring cancer battle. She was predeceased by her parents and son Christopher, the youngest. She's survived by her husband George Peter Jr. George Sr. was the MD. Her sons George Sr., who's married to Suzanne sitting next to him, and Paul, her brother, who was in California, her brother Jacques, and five nieces and nephews were most here. A memorial service will be at 10 a.m., if we're following things right, at Cornerstone Baptist. Donations may be made to the Timothy Scholarship Fund at Cornerstone Baptist. That's the Timothy Scholarship Fund. You have the address. Or the Gougatas Kypros Scholarship Foundation Fund at Madonna. So that's my Fasolaki.
I'm Eunice Ross. Bess said she wanted me to speak as her Christian roommate. And I have to tell you, that day in September day in 1955, as I looked out the window from the 11th floor of what was the Student Center at Wayne State University, I was very aware of the activity of God in getting me there. But I was still unsure about how he was going to answer my prayer for a Christian roommate. I heard some noise at the door, and I turned to see a dark-haired girl walking in with a great big family Bible in her arms. Wow! What is this? What kind of an answer? We were both just awestruck as we realized how specifically God had answered both our prayers. Bess was a leader, and Jack has outlined some of the things that she showed her leadership in. But I would like to tell you what kind of a leader she was. She was quiet, confident, enduring, energetic, committed, wise, organized, not a dictatorial, not flamboyant, but just supportive as a leader. She never really seemed to challenge her Christianity with her questions, but rather pursued understanding what other people's questions were. We really influenced each other a great deal in seeking Christian fellowship in our college years, which was very necessary for me. She was pretty confident in hers, but I was sort of, should I say, easily questioning. We had crazy but fun times in our lives together. Such things, crazy things in putting our life together, as cooking in our room, which was sort of against the rules, with an electric percolator and an electric frying pan, making a Sunday dinner with canned green beans and canned roast beef and instant potatoes, making instant coffee from the hot water in the faucet. Her musical tingling punctuated our days. Her musical laugh tingling punctuated our days. She and I assisted her in organizing dorm Bible studies, leading us as a group of friends in holding a child's evangelism Bible club in a nearby school, which was then it's probably about where the 275 freeway is on Warren at this time. But we had probably about 75 children that came to that class. And Bess had flannel graphs that she had brought from Mansfield, Ohio, where she had learned how to do child evangelism. It wasn't too long before Bess started talking about her interest in George Kipros and her dreams that sometime they would be together. It was really exciting to see that develop. Some of her life really made sense in terms of her development. As you can see, we started out raising our children together with very little knowledge other than reading very few books that were available at that time. But we would talk every day on the phone about our problems and our joys with our kids and get together at least once or twice a week. And our kids really remember being in each other's birthday parties, integrating whether it was boys or girls. George maybe remembers being the only boy at my daughter's birthday parties along with Paul. Later, she took those experiences through to her academic work that ended at Madonna. As I prepared for this talk today, that family Bible vignette really stayed in my mind. And I realized that that was an integration of her family upbringing and her own choices to deepen her faith in Jesus Christ. Along with that, the word cornerstone came to me through a song that was really meaningful as I was putting this together. I want to read a couple verses of it to you. In Christ Alone is the name of it. It's by Stuart Townsend. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my strength, my light, and my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and strivings cease. My comforter, my awe in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. those two connections, my beginning in seeing her walk in with that family Bible, and the ending of her physical life here on earth at Cornerstone, are very significant to me, and I hope they become significant to you.
I invite you to take your hymnal again. Turn to number 43. 43. Let us sing with confidence and with gratitude of God's faithfulness. Would you stand as we sing?
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassion, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever with me. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy
This time we're scheduled to hear from Dr. Karen Obzniak. Is she here? If not, Denise.
Good morning. I'm Denise Hardy, the Women's Ministry Director here at Cornerstone, and it is my pleasure to give you a peek into Bess's heart. We've heard so much about her accomplishments, and I'm going to speak of that as well. But I want you to hear the heart behind her accomplishments. So Bess was involved in the ministry of the church. She wanted to speak the gospel into the lives of all that she met. Bess began to work with me on the women's ministry team many, many years ago. We attended conferences together. We met together regularly, working side by side for the women's ministry here at Cornerstone. She loved the church. Bess knew how important it was for her to be prepared to help and minister to others. She spent time in studying the scriptures and reading theology books. She always wanted to grow to be more like Jesus. Her heart attitude was one of humility. She never believed she had all the answers and was willing to hear from others on matters of theology. It would humble me so much when Bess would call me with a question. I was very humbled because I knew how smart that woman was. But Bess loved learning more about God. Bible study was important to Bess. She began a Bible study for our women to help them to study the Bible more effectively. She loved to teach our women here. She taught some classes on Wednesday evenings and as part of our elective curriculum. She herself also attended Bible study fellowship and neighborhood Bible study. Studying the scripture was so important to her that when she and George went up north for their vacation time, she would take studies with her and she would do studies with the women up north. She loved the Word of God. Bess was responsible for our Hope for You ministry for many years. This ministry was a great support to our women with cancer or other life-threatening health issues. She made sure that they were prepared for chemo or radiation or any other treatments that they may have to have. She contacted them regularly, checking up on their progress. Bess wanted to bring the Word of God to bear in their lives so that she would have So to do that, she would have speakers come in and challenge the ladies with God's word, even when they were going through these difficult times. She loved to help those who were suffering. Another ministry Bess was involved in, and I believe she began, was the tutoring ministries to the students at Connor Creek School. She organized people to go there and tutor individual students, giving them the opportunity to help them with their education while building a bridge of support for that student. She was passionate about coming alongside of these students to help with their education. She loved to educate others. One of the ministries that Bess always wanted us to have here at Cornerstone was a book club. While she was still working, she talked about it a lot, but once she retired, we put a green light to that book club, and she started one here at Cornerstone. Reading was her passion. She couldn't read enough. Her reading was so varied. She would read about so many different subjects. The book club now is still part of the women's ministry and is very important for fellowship of our women, as well as they gain some education along the way too. This group really blossomed under Bess's leadership. And during the time when Bess was in hospice, the book club would take their discussion and go and sit in Bess's family room with her and go through their book discussion. These women cared deeply for Bess. Bess loved books. But she loved people more. Bess's heart desire was for people to know God. She wanted people to know how God can get you through the hard times of life. She wanted people to know about the joy that God had given her during some very trying times in her life. So, she's on hospice care, and Bess decides to write a book. And she did write a book. She wrote a 30-day devotional of joy. And when she finished it, I picked it up, and many people helped to edit it, and then we had it published. After it was published, and I worked very hard to get that done for her, I was with her was to show her her book. And as she held her book, she rubbed it, and then she got out a piece of paper. And here's what she wrote: "Make sure that every family that is at my service gets a copy of my book." Now, the reason that Bess wanted that to happen is because she has a desire for people to know God. That's why she wanted it to happen. And so today, when you leave in the gathering space on that side, please come to the table and get a book that Bess penned in the last days of her life. And we will make sure that everybody has a copy, and if we run out, we'll take your name. I want you to know that Bess loved each of you here. Her ministry will go on with the words of this book. She so wanted people to trust God and to know him more. When speaking with George after the book was published, I sat at the table and talked with him, and I think he summed it up best. He said, "She really loves God." Yes, Bess really loved God, and her desire is that you would really love him too.
Thank you.
3 years ago, Bess wrote out the order of this service. She planned for this day. You know, Bess has always had a way of kind of getting her way, right, George? She even wrote out his obituary. My orders from Bess are now to explain to you from the scriptures why Bess lived with so much hope and joy and this resting confidence that just exuded from her life in spite of the adversity that she lived with. My charge, in a word, is to help you clearly understand what the Bible calls the gospel. And gospel literally means good news. The longest New Testament epistle in the Bible is the book of Romans, and that particular book is focused on the gospel, but it doesn't start out with good news. If you ever took the time to read the book of Romans, you will find out that at the beginning of this book, it is very offensive to proud people. It is devastating to thoughtful ones because the message of this book is hard to bear. And in essence, what the book of Romans says at the beginning is that if you are an immoral person, you are a rebel who deserves the just and righteous wrath of God. If you are a moral person, you are a rebel who deserves the just and righteous wrath of God. If you are a religious person, you are a self-righteous rebel who deserves the just and righteous wrath of God. And that pretty much hits all of us, doesn't it? That not only sums up the beginning of the book of Romans, it basically sums up you and me and our world. In fact, if you look at chapter 3 from verse 9 through verse 20. You read a summary of our condition. It is hard to read because it is so true. Those verses are like surgery that just expose our hearts. We hide our hearts under the way we dress, the way we appear, the image we seek to project. God knows the truth about every single one of us. And the summary is that no one is truly righteous, and therefore no one can save himself, and no one can do anything to earn the favor of God. We need to be rescued. If we were to stand before God, we need righteousness, and we don't have righteousness. And that means that our problem is twofold. We're not only guilty of sin, and we need our sin to be removed, but we need righteousness, and we don't have any. Then comes the good news. Then comes chapter 3. Verses 21 through 26, where we read six of some of the most densely packed, theologically loaded, glorious verses in all of the Bible. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that, and this is the purpose clause of the whole thing, so that, here's where the whole thing drives, so that he, God, might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. God is just and the justifier. I want you to feel that tension. If God is just, as he says he is, then his justice has to be perfect. That means he has to be perfectly fair. That means he is the umpire whose strike zone never changes. But if God is perfectly just, that is devastating to us. It means we don't have hope. Because even the best things that you and I do, even when we are having a day when we're just at the very top of our game and we actually do something that was really, really good, even that is tainted with some self-centered motives. And this is the quandary, it seems, for God. How can God be just and forgive sin? Have you ever thought about that? How can God forgive you of your sin? You pray and you ask God to forgive you and you assume that he's going to forgive you. How can he do that? How can God say to you, to me, it's okay, when it's not okay? How can God say it's okay when it's not okay and God still be okay? Okay? That is a real tension. How can a judge say to somebody who is guilty, it's okay? But if God doesn't forgive you, you don't have hope. God has to be just. But at the same time, God is the justifier. And that is why verses 24 and 25 are two of the most glorious verses in the Bible. And in those two verses, there are five words that I want you to understand. So I'm going to explain these five words, give you an illustration, and a final story. All right? Word number one. It's the word justified. And I know, this sounds a little heavy. It is heavy. This is life and death. And this is why Bess charged me with this glorious task. Because it was this truth that changed her life. It was this truth that drove everything about this dear lady. She was changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. So that first word, justified. The Bible says in verse 23, all have sinned, all fall short of the glory of God, all therefore deserving of the righteous wrath of God, but, verse 24, are justified by his grace. That word justified does not mean to be made righteous, it means to be declared righteous. What that means is that when a person recognizes that Christ came to this earth and he lived the life you could not live and died the death you could not die, that when you put your faith in Christ, you receive the benefits of his life. You receive the benefits of his death. You are credited with his life. You are credited with his death. And how that affects us is that our sin that we have committed is taken from us, credited to Christ, who died to pay the penalty for that sin. That sin is removed off of us, and the life that Christ lived, that infinitely righteous life that he lived, his life is credited to us. What an exchange! He takes our sin and gives us his life. And because our sin is removed from us and his life is credited to us, that means that the Father looks at us through the lens of his Son. And he sees us with the same affection as he sees his Son. And he looks at us through the lens of what his Son accomplished on our behalf. And he says, because of his Son and what his Son did in living for us, in dying for us, he looks at us and says, you are righteous. It's not our righteousness. It is an alien righteousness. It is a righteousness outside of us. It is a righteousness from Christ. That is what the word justified means. It means in the sight of God to be declared righteous. Verse 23 says, all have sinned, all fall short of the glory of God, but are declared righteous by his grace. That's the second word, grace. We use that word a lot. And yet oftentimes we think of grace as a little bit of additional help that God gives us. And we just can't get there on, you know, kind of like Home Depot, you know what I mean? You can do it, we can help. You know, you're almost there, just let us help finish it off. That's not grace. And yet that's kind of how many of us think that, you know, I'm basically a pretty good person. I just need a little help getting over the top. I just need a little bit of grace to help. No, that's not the message of the scripture. Message of the scripture, you're a train wreck. It is in that context you need to understand grace. Members of my church are familiar with this illustration that I like to use, because the Roseville police love to sit in our parking lot and take and get to know people driving up and down 12 Mile. It's a friendly little chat they have, you know, after they check out your license and registration, and they just usually give you a little piece of paper in return. But what they do is, because there's a 45 mile an hour speed limit there, they will pull people over, and if you're driving over 45 miles an hour, you are speeding. And if you are speeding and they give you a ticket, that's fair. That's just. You've gotten what you deserve. If you're going over the speed limit and you get pulled over and they give you a warning, that's called mercy. Mercy's not getting what you deserve. If, however, you're speeding, you get pulled over by the police, and instead of giving you a ticket, and instead of just giving you a warning, the police officer happens to give you a $250 gift card to Costco, you would think you just had an out-of-body experience, didn't you? But that's grace. Grace is getting what you do not deserve. That's how the scripture uses the word grace. We are justified by his grace. What Christ has done is he has given us something we do not deserve. That's why grace is a gift. We're justified by his grace as a gift through the, here's our third word, redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Redemption means, I think most of you know, to buy back that which is rightfully yours. God made you. Your DNA has the stamp of God in it. The details of your life, the very fact that you have eternity in your heart, you long to live, you have been made by God. You've been made in his image. But you and the rest of humanity, we have rebelled against God. We have said, I'll go my own way, do my own thing, live my own life. And what God did, he sent Christ to buy you back. That's redemption. He sent Christ to get you back from the consequences of your own rebellion. And he did that, verse 25 says, and here's our fourth word. It's a long one, whom God put forward as a propitiation. That's a really technical word, but it is an absolutely critical truth. Propitiation means a wrath-absorbing, wrath-appeasing sacrifice. And what Christ did when he died on the cross is he absorbed upon himself all of the wrath of a just God that should be poured out on you. It was poured out on Christ. And what that means is there's nothing left for you to pay. There's nothing left for you to do in an effort to earn the favor of God. There's nothing left for you to do in an effort to try to pay for your sin. Christ paid it all. He absorbed in himself. He was the propitiation for your sin. To be received by, here's our fifth word, faith. All of this that Christ has done for you, is for you. It's for you. It's for you is a gift. It's a gift. It's received. It's a gift. It's received without you having to pay for it. It's received for you to accept. To accept that gift is to believe it. To believe it as your own, to recognize that's my sin that Christ died for. That's my guilt that he paid for. That's my punishment that he absorbed. And his righteousness it's mine to believe. George has given his life to medicine. Bess has given her life to people and particularly children. There's a place in Memphis, Tennessee that puts those two together. I think many of you have heard of it, St. Jude Children's Research Center. If you have a child who is suffering from a life-threatening illness, particularly some kind of childhood cancer, that is a facility that specializes in that. The research that is done at that facility is phenomenal. A child's DNA is kept on record there, and what the researchers will do is they will look personally at the particular DNA of that child, look at the particular disease that the child has, and they have developed these protocols for that particular illness, but they will specialize that protocol for that child. And then there are people who oversee that protocol down to the minute so that things are followed exactly, and the success rate is remarkable. Do you know that God knows the particular need that you have, the particular effect of sin in your life, and he sent Christ as the precise and complete solution for you? A parent would be foolish to walk away from the research center, taking their child with them, saying, "We'll do this ourselves." Just as you would be a fool to turn away from Christ, who alone can rescue you. There's two things that you can do in a more formal sense to speak to people after you have passed away. One is you can write a book. The second is you can put something on your tombstone, so the people who visit will be reminded of the message of your life. In Bess's case, she decided to do both. I've waited a long time to be able to tell you this story. Behind you is what we call the gathering space of our church, and outside of the gathering space, outside that wall of windows, there's a clock. A couple of years ago, that clock appeared to just appear. And members of the church were, "Where'd that come from? We didn't see that in the budget." And it wasn't in the budget because it was a gift to this church. Not only from George and Bess, but it was a gift because at the base of that clock, there's a place for the remains of Bess and Christopher and for George. Because Bess wanted you to know that she wanted to be buried here, because she loves the gospel, and she never wants anybody to forget that. So in a private service, we will put her mortal remains there. My hope is that as you see that clock, you will know she lived her hours well, and she's now in the place where there is no time. And may that be a reminder to you to know your days are numbered. Will you trust Christ? Father, we thank you for your mercies in our lives. And we know that they are grounded in Christ. And we thank you for your servant, Bess, whose life was changed by the gospel. And I pray that not only because of her life, but now in her death, that many more will come to Christ, whom she loved, and who is life and forgiveness and joy forever and ever. In Jesus' name we pray.
I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. Shall sound, and the dead shall be raised, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. The trumpet shall sound. And we shall
And with that, you are dismissed.